1 billion people worldwide live without clean water. Nearly 2 billion people worldwide drink unsafe water. 1 billion people lack access to improved sanitation. More than 5% of all child deaths can be prevented with safe water and sanitation. But there has been tremendous progress between 1990 and 2012. 2.3 billion people gained access to an improved drinking water source. Guess what? What you and I think is normal is not. It is just not. Can you imagine not being able just to open that faucet or just to flush that toilet? None of that. What a different story that would be. With me today is a special guest. It's William Mendoza. And when you hear his story, you would never expect that he would become passionate about clean water. William, welcome to the show.
Thank you very much for having me.
Yeah, so, now, you were raised in San Francisco.
That's right.
You got from there, you were excited about it, but you weren't happy about your environment.
That's right.
Why not?
In my environment, what I grew up around and was in the Mission District of San Francisco. It's a beautiful place. And there was a lot of drugs, drinking, prostitution, gangs, and other types of things that go on. And that was around me, so it made me feel less secure, unsafe, and so I figured, you know, it was time to move, so I kind of packed my bags at 17 after I graduated and moved to Los Angeles.
Well, wait a minute. Don't you know L.A., it's usually worse?
Yeah, you know,
exactly. I know, like that. I'm sorry. And that is me sitting from another country, you know?
Totally, exactly.
I'm like, duh.
L.A. was basically...
Why L.A.?
Well, I had an uncle who... who lived there, and I saw hope. He was doing great, and I saw like an opportunity to grow. So I went there and started working. Uh-huh. And then, you know, one thing kind of led to another. I didn't know who I was as a young man. My identity was in basically everything around me back then.
Now, what I'm really hearing often when people, especially young men, struggle with identity, there is no dad in the house. Was that your case?
You know, actually, that was my case, yeah. He was around sometimes and not, but yeah, he struggled a lot in life for sure.
Okay, yes. So you move to LA and you make your dream, you get away from drugs and gangs,
that's
right?
Yeah, I was addicted to drugs for 16 years.
Oh, so you did fall for it.
I did fall for it, yes. I was about 21 and just hanging out with some friends, and I had no idea like what I was about to consume. I had no idea what I was about to consume was about to consume me for 16 long years. And it was just that one moment of like, hey, you know what, trying to fit in, didn't know my identity, trying to be cool.
That one shot, that one.
And I literally was like, sure, I'll try some. Literally, that very moment, I was addicted. That moment, like I knew the next day, I was like, I'm addicted.
Is it that easy to get addicted to drugs?
Well, you know what, for my makeup, it was. And it was a struggle. It was probably one of the hardest things that I've experienced in life. And you know, by the grace of God, I'm here. I feel like I'm a miracle walking, and I'm just blessed.
So what was your wake-up call? Because, you know, you're sitting here right now, and it all looks great.
Yeah.
You look amazing.
Thanks.
But then that moment, what was that turnaround moment? You know, a lot of people have, I'm sorry, but wake-up calls in jail.
Right.
But then the moment they get out, it starts all over again.
That's right.
So
that's
what was yours?
Well, you know, I ended up getting in a fight. Got arrested, and then I woke up in the morning in jail.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I did, in jail. And it was about probably 5 in the morning, and my head was under the toilet. And I was like, this is not what I was created for. I'm a good man. I have a great heart. I love people.
Wait. You're in jail because you're a fight, and you're saying you're not such a bad guy after all?
No, because I didn't know who I was, you know, but I was defending myself.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
like they all say, right?
No. Yeah, exactly.
But I realized that I was living for myself and not living for something greater than myself. Mm. So I literally accepted Jesus Christ. I'm like, Jesus Christ, I accept you into my life. Whatever I need to do, I will do.
Was that a wake-up revelation for you, or was there somebody that came in jail that presented it to you?
No, it was a moment. It's either now or never.
Okay.
So I was like sitting down on my rear end on the floor, and I was like, I accept you into my life, and...
You knew.
I knew. I knew if I didn't, that I would be dead soon.
Wow, right. Yeah. I work a lot in juvenile hall,
okay.
And what I see coming in and out and the stories
That's right.
And the ones that die...
Right.
It is just heart-wrenching.
It is.
It's just heart-wrenching, especially when you see they know,
yes.
but they fall right back. Now, usually it is the root of the problem inside of your heart.
That's right.
That makes you go back to the problem to begin with.
That's right.
So what kept you out?
I started seeking the Lord. I started seeking Him on my own. And then I attended a Bible study, and I walked into a Bible study, and there were a lot. I walked in, and I was like, I don't know if I belong here. They're more like in their 70s, 80s. And I felt like I didn't fit there. I'm like, this is not. It was brand new. But I stayed there. And to this day, these are my best friends. I could not imagine my life any different. They have helped me grow as a man.
And they'll be the mentors to help you move on and not just say, see you later.
That's correct. Yeah, absolutely.
So you, from there, started flourishing in something around water filters.
Yes.
How did that came about?
Well, you know, I was... I knew my life was changing, and I saw how my life was changing because of the Word of God. And I'm like, if He could change my life, the Lord, boy, He can change others. Like, I was hopeless. And my father's from El Salvador as well, so I figured I knew there was a gang problem going on in El Salvador between the world's most dangerous gangs.
Isn't that one of the worst countries with gangs?
It is the most murders in the world from there, over there.
Oh, wow.
So we entered a truce between the Mara Salvatrucha and Barrio 18, which is the world's most dangerous gangs. And they had a truce. From the murder rate was at 48 a day, and it went down to like 2 a day. Right.
So it worked? The truce actually worked?
It was working. And so we entered, and we wanted to reward them. So we went into every prison in El Salvador, brought clean water, access to clean water.
This costs money for an ex-convict that was in jail.
Right.
For who knows how long,
right.
And you come out, and then for you to say, hey, give me money, I'm gonna help people in El Salvador. They're all like, yeah, right.
Well, good.
I'm sorry, I'm just being realistic right now, you know?
Yeah.
That doesn't, unless God's in it, that ain't working.
Right, and God was in it, and that's a great point to make too, because I was like, you know what, they look at me and my record, I'm going, trying to go help,
exactly.
You know, gang members, like,
yeah.
What's really going on? By the grace of God, he allowed me to start a for-profit company.
And I want more about that.
Sure.
A whole lot more. You know, there's more to this, obviously. Stay tuned. You want to see this. We'll be right back.
Hi, I'm Diane Gardner of BeautifulWomenOfGod.org, and I've just been here with Barbara Marshall. If you've not seen the program, take time. Do you have friends that are struggling with things? Are you looking for answers on how to help some of those friends? This program is the real deal, and the real deal is here for you. Barbara has such love for people, and it just comes across in the broadcast. And I want you to tune in to Barb TV and tell your friends, because she's here to meet your needs and make sure you know what the real deal is.
In a 2014 study that looked at prison inmate statistics in over 40 states, more than 4 in 10 offenders returned to state prison within 3 years of their release. And over 75% were back in prison within 5 years. Now, you were the exception to that. You were the 25%.
I have been blessed, and I can't take this lightly. That's why I gave my life up to Christ, and so I could help others know that there is a way.
You completely turn that around. So you're talking about water filters,
yes.
And saying, hi, I'm an ex-convict, give me money, right?
Well,
I'm like,
yeah.
So how? Why the passion? Why water? Because you're from El Salvador and you knew, or why?
Water was access to work with the gang members in El Salvador.
Now, why are you so passionate to help them? They're gonna kill ya.
You know what? I was dead before.
That's true.
Being a drug addict.
You are much better off now.
One day,
and they can
with Christ,
see you because you recognize each other.
Yeah, that's right. Yeah.
So it sounds wrong, you know, but that is what it is.
No.
So you're there. Were you able to get the funding? Didn't you start a company?
Yeah, I started a company and I funded it on my own. And I knew, almost was feeling like I was making up, Lord, whatever, I'm going to do it, you know. So yes, I funded it on my own by the grace of the Lord, and blessed to do the work. You're like, what more can I say? I'm just really blessed.
Okay, so you go to El Salvador.
Yes.
You just go onto the streets, I assume, with a team.
It was myself and one other person, and then we had our meetings with the gangs. Also with some of the...
And you just knock on their door, hi gang,
no,
here I am.
Through mutual friends. And we also met with the government as well to get inside of the prisons to work there. We needed permission. So we had to obviously show that we were...
Legit,
exactly.
Now, how bad is the water in El Salvador?
It's terrible out there. The water... imagine just looking at water. Some of it looks like urine, and some of it would have urine in it and feces too. So, not everyone in El Salvador. I would say about 70% of people in El Salvador don't have access to clean water.
70%.
Yes.
How come that's not provided for by the government?
You know, I don't know. You know.
Okay.
Yeah, each government's different.
So you right? go, the first time you walked out there, you're in Salvador.
That's right.
You have your company.
That's right.
You walk in with water bottles or water...
Actually,
because
yeah.
just bringing a water bottle is just putting like...
That's, yeah.
Not, it's not... No. You need something lasting, man.
That's right. So we have water filters about the size of my palm, and they last about 15 years, and they filter out 500 gallons a day.
That's pretty good.
It's great, yeah. And they filter out 99.99% of all parasites and metals. So we gave each prison, we would, depending on how many prisoners they had in there, we had directors that would be in charge of each filter. So say 150 people we in charge, actually would have one filter, and one person or three people would be in charge of maintaining the filter, cleaning it. So yeah, so it worked like that. Depending on the numbers of each prison we went to, that would determine how many filters we would leave.
Now, tell me a little bit about this filter. Did you create it? Did you come up? Because now I'm already thinking, typical
yeah.
American,
right,
you know,
right.
is it has to be efficient, it has to be easy,
That's
it
right.
has to be cleanable.
Yeah.
But to actually create that, these filters could, what are they, $20 a piece?
Yeah, you know, they're more expensive than that, but they do change lives. So basically, through a friend in the Florida area, definitely started a company and created these filters. So we're basically utilizing these filters as an opportunity to go bring the Word of God spiritually and physically.
And once you bring in the water,
that's right,
they receive the spiritual as well.
That's right.
Is that how you're doing it?
Yes. So we make sure that we bring water, the spiritual water and the physical water too.
Now, something I saw on your website, that you don't just go to the gangs, but also the trafficked people. And
absolutely.
Pimps are usually very protective
yeah.
over their people. They are protective.
That's right.
I've seen it. I've been working with somebody in the United States,
That's
and there,
right.
there, she, a girl called me just last week, and she says, Barb, remember me, trafficked girl, and chose to go back to trafficking by her own choice.
Yeah.
You know, they're stuck.
That's right.
And listen to that, and I'm like, yeah. And then instantly you hear in the background, who's that? And click,
oh,
next.
Wow.
You know,
yeah.
So, but why would they want to connect with you then, you
yeah.
know? Because those pimps, aren't they like back off?
Great question. We don't only work with gang members. We also work in communities, schools, orphanages, elderly facilities, excuse me. So that was just our first project. So we work around the world. We just came back from Cambodia about a month ago. And we work with another organization called AIM, Agape International Missions, and
okay.
they help rescue young girls and children from sex trafficking.
Good.
So
Good.
We help bring clean water to their facilities,
as
well as communities throughout the entire country of Cambodia.
Okay.
Yeah.
So you're in Cambodia.
That's
you're
correct.
In El Salvador.
Guatemala.
Yeah.
We also do Kenya, Mexico, and we have Sri Lanka coming up, and Peru.
Oh my goodness, those are all those kind of third world country
That's
type.
Correct.
Definitely. So how long have you been doing it at this point?
2011 we started.
So it's been about almost 6 years.
That's right.
Basically,
right.
You're into it 6 years. Tell me one of your success stories.
Jesus Christ, he saved my life. Like that's a success story for me.
Well, yeah, I'm not talking about that. So
yeah.
Give me a little bit of a story of somebody that it just transformed their lives, because you're going into these countries,
sure.
but as long as there's no water, is hope all gone? Is it just like they know they're not moving forward in life as long as they don't have that clean water?
Absolutely.
So I was wondering, once they get access to clean water, does that not just change what they have, but also their way of thinking?
Absolutely. Dirty water can cripple a nation. So what we do is we basically, these children that do not have clean water at home, They end up getting sick. They can't go to school. The parents can't go to work. So they're at home. They're not working. No income's coming in. So a success story, I would say, is working with a family in the El Salvador area that did not have clean water. And so we brought clean water to them. And they were actually working in the streets, gang members as well. And they're hanging up their gloves, I guess you would say, you know, stopping because they had access to clean water and went to get jobs without.
Wow, so it changed everything.
Yeah, exactly, changing.
You know what, isn't that amazing? Clean water, but we're so used to just easily letting that water at the lawn run and all that, and it makes a whole lot of impact if you're not used to it or have it in any way, shape, or form. But there's hope, and I see Jesus just working in an incredible, powerful way to the people that never thought that would be any way at all. And here it is. Here's William going into El Salvador. Stay tuned. There's more. We will be right back.
For all of you out there who are suffering from things when you just feel like there's no answers, there's no way that you can get out of the situation that you're in, I am the prayer warrior for Barb TV and Love Your Life Ministries, and I'm part of the board. And so it's my job to pray for you out there. And so if you have a prayer request, we encourage you to contact us at barbtv.org and ask for prayer, and we will pray for your needs. And I just want to encourage you not to be feel like you're alone, but that there are people who will do God's work, and they will pray for you when you need prayer. So give us a call and let us know what your needs are, and God will answer those prayers.
In 2012, it was estimated that 500,000 deaths globally were caused by inadequate drinking water, and another 280,000 deaths by inadequate sanitation. Can you imagine? The most likely estimate of disease burden from inadequate hand hygiene amounts to over 290,000 deaths. In children under 5 years old, a reported 360,000 deaths could be prevented just by improving water and sanitation practices in their area. Now, you're working at this. When I read those numbers, you're basically a drop in the bucket.
Right, that's right.
So what helps you to keep going and say, this is too big, this is too much?
You know, seeing the changes in the families, when we go back to monitor and see how the filter's working, to see them being, thank you so much just for this water, like, we're actually able to go to work. The kids are able to go to school. We're not spending our money on the hospital bill with the doctors. And we're able to actually sometimes sell the water to neighbors sometimes.
Oh, smart move.
Yeah, so it really works out.
Now, when you reach a lot of people with water, and not everybody, of course, accepts Christ.
Correct.
What is the ratio? Because it is such a life-changing for them. You expect this experience. Because they're in a society, they're probably, why would you help me?
That's correct. You know, can you repeat that again? I'm so sorry. Like,
it's okay.
Yeah,
it's just, I don't think everybody accepts Christ that
right.
you minister to.
No, that's right.
So are there some people, what is the ratio of those that actually turn to that life-giving water, you know, the
gotcha.
Spiritual life-giving water?
Well, I think our mission is to bring the love of Christ out there and to see that we're not trying to convert you. Of course, we want you to know who Jesus Christ is, because he can help change your life and, you know, get you through situations, and he's actually gives you hope. So that's our main intention, to let them see Christ through our actions. And then, of course, we ask if they would like to have a Bible study, know more about him, and then we tell them all about Jesus Christ and, you know, how...
How many of on a ratio is it, like 1 to 2 or 1 to 10 that say, I want more?
You know, I would say probably 1 out of 10, I would say.
Okay.
1 out of 10, you know... we are actually keeping track of the health and their the cleaning of the water, but we do keep contact with them, letting them know that Christ does work and change, for sure.
That's good. So I'm sure you've seen some sad stories out there.
That's right.
tell us something. How can we make a difference, you know?
You know, actually, you can make a difference by, if you would like to donate to the Mission for Life, La Misión por Vida.
Yeah, we can't ask for donations, is there any way that they could get more information? What's your website?
Absolutely. The website is, you can go to themissionforlife.org. And our name is La Misión por Vida, but in English it is themissionforlife.org.
The Mission for Life. And it's literally life-giving water.
It is life-giving water, right.
So if there is one advice that you could give right now to the viewer that's listening and was like, wow, you know, I could actually become part of this in one way, shape, or form.
That's right.
What would you tell them?
We can be used no matter what situation you're in. I think just giving and sacrificing something of your life to help somebody else, I think it's a part of life that we need to be doing, whether you're a Christian or not. I think just giving, I think it's an important thing.
Okay. Yeah. So now you've got a big tattoo on your hand right there.
That's right.
Well, what does it mean? You know, it has numbers, and I think it's great when you go to gangs because they'll feel instantly related. But what does it mean?
Actually, it's John 7:24 in the Bible, and it means do not judge upon appearances, but judge with right judgment. Know before you start coming to judgment with someone. Know their heart, who they are.
Now, why that? Is that because you're working with gangs? Or what is the reason that you chose that Bible verse?
It really stuck with me because whether it's prejudices, it's not even about, you know, just gangs. It's about people in general.
Yeah.
You know, it could be from a Latino to an African-American, you know, Middle Eastern. And, you know, society sometimes gives the wrong message of to people, about people.
Yeah.
And I think it's important that we just accept everyone as brothers and sisters of Christ, and that's important.
I think that's beautiful. Yeah. One more time, your website, if somebody wants to get more information.
Sure, if you can go to themissionforlife.org.
That sounds great.
Yes.
Thank you so much for joining us on the show. I'm going to give you my book, Ransomed.
Thank you, Barbara.
And give it to a woman that needs to learn to love their life from the inside out.
Amen, thank you.
Thank you so much
thank
for coming
so much.
To us. And you know, Jesus talked about water. He really did. In John 4, and I'm going to talk to you about it out of the New Living Translation. And at verse 10, it says, Jesus replied to a woman that is trying to hide from people, that is going to get water, and that is not getting the help that it needs. And it says right there, Jesus replied, if you only knew the gift of God has for you, and you are who you are speaking to, you would ask me, and I would give you living water. And then the woman says, what? Wait, why? No, that's not. And all the excuses of the world, which we are so good about. But then he replies to her and it says, anyone who drinks this water will soon become thirsty again. The water out of the well, the water from a filter, water out there. But those who drink the water I give will never be thirsty again. It becomes a fresh, bubbling spring within them, giving them eternal life. And the woman questions it and she says, where should we worship? And uses her excuses all over again. Why? Because she's hurting. Why? Because she's focusing out of her pain. But then Jesus gets to the core, addresses that pain, and then Jesus replies in verse 21. And he says, believe me, dear woman, the time is coming when it will no longer matter whether you worship the Father on this mountain or in Jerusalem. You Samaritans know very little about the one you worship, while we Jews know all about him, for salvation comes through the Jews. But the time is coming indeed, it's here now, when true worshipers will worship the Father in spirit and in truth. In spirit and in truth. The Father is looking for those who will worship him that way. For God is spirit, so those who worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. And the woman will try to derail it. And she says, I know Messiah is coming, the one who's called Christ. When he comes, he will explain everything to us. But then Jesus says, I am the Messiah. And what Jesus wants to tell you right now, I am the expected one. I am the Savior. I am here to help you. I am ready to give you living water and for it to bubble out of your innermost deepest. I am here to bring you joy. I am here to give you life-giving life, eternal life. I am here to transform your life in a way that you will never be the same and you're gonna love it. And you know, my friends, that is what I saw in William. And instead of falling back, that's 75% over a period of less than 5 years. He chose the opposite, and that's what God wants for you. So call me. I want to pray with you. We have a team with us. 855-515-5550. Or go to our website, barbtv.org, and know this, that if God is willing to help a woman that has been married for 5 times and is now living with a guy that is not even her own, if she is willing to do all that and Jesus says, I am coming to help her, he will also help you. You are no mistake. You were born for a reason. Let us pray with you. Let us love on you and get to know him. Again, 855-515-5550 or go to barbtv.org and know this. God will never leave you or forsake you, but he will always be there, even if it's in the midst of gangs or as a prostitute. He is going to help you. If you have any questions, will you please contact me? What I see right now is that there is somebody listening right now that is just in turmoil inside saying, how do I get that life-giving water? Ask Jesus in your heart. Believe that he died on the cross and rose from the dead. Say it out loud and he will come in. God loves you. Call us. And so do I. See you soon. The most common form of maternal abandonment is physical. When a mother physically leaves her child behind, this kind of abandonment is sudden and unexpected, causing the child to feel shocked that her mother has chosen to leave her. Wasn't she in full denial, completely?
Oh, sure.
Ignoring the entire, but how long can you ignore a 9-month-old bump? You know, it doesn't happen like that. But no child wants to find out she was left to die.
Right. And when he was 16, he went back to visit friends and bumped into that doctor. And the doctor said, so, how's the family? How's your mom? How's your little sister? You know, I always hated doing abortions like that. My mother was 41 when I was born, and she didn't want any more children because she already had 4 boys.